From the dark web to your radio dial, you are listening to Cyber Talk Radio on News 1200 WOAI.
Welcome to Cyber Talk Radio. I'm your host, Bret Piatt, a 20-year internet security veteran. I'm joined this week by DigitalTown and their VP of Global Operations, Frank Robles. Frank, thank you for coming in and joining us this week on the program.
Thank you for having me.
So how did you end up in the geekdom community yourself and with DigitalTown?
Oh, I'm a longtime geekdom member. I'm going back to the beginning, actually. Early on, I had an office at the Weston Center. And before the move over to the new location.
And so 5 years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then in the middle of there, I was recruited into Austin to be a CTO for the Austin Board of Realtors for a while. So that drew me to Austin. But now I'm back working on San Antonio stuff.
So now we're working on this. So what is your mission with DigitalTown?
It's truly twofold. One, it's breaking the old paradigm of the extraction economy. I mean, there's so many companies that have succeeded so well in the digital realm, but the local communities are suffering. You know, that money that's being generated is being taken away from the community instead of brought to the community. So we've developed a solution to enable people to service the need, but not take the money out of the community. And the second fold is great building adoption, because it's really a movement. People need to understand there's a value of buying local and supporting that.
Which is hard to do on the internet.
It's very hard to do on the internet. We're mostly mobile focused. We have an app because most of the transactions seem to come over phones nowadays. So we make it pretty easy for people. And we're moving a lot of the friction that's involved normally in those transactions.
So as you're going to connect locally owned small businesses, I guess, primarily with the internet and internet commerce.
Well, it's not limited to small businesses, but yes, primarily small businesses appreciate some of those things first. I'm listing their business for free on the site and on the phone. That's kind of an attractive thing. There's a couple of interesting factors that we've done. One is that not just listing the item, you can actually search our system locally and find something local. And I'll give you an example. Right now, we have most of the restaurant's menus already indexed in the system. So you can search for a menu item, and we'll show you on a map where you can find that menu item. So you can search for barbacoa tacos here in San Antonio, and I'll show you a map on the system on where you can go buy those barbacoa tacos close to you. And if that restaurant actually signs up with us, you can order that taco through the system right there on your phone. Just click on it and order it. And now we have it where retailers can put their goods there, and also with local search, you can find that retail good locally and go get it. And that's kind of a dream thing, at least for me. I was involved with Google Earth as an investor early on and promoted it with Google. And right now in Google, you can find a location in an instant just doing a search. It's no problem. But if you go inside of one of those stores, you pull something off the shelf, you search for it, you're going to find Amazon or some company in China. That doesn't help the local community. That's been eviscerating the local community. But with our system now, you can actually find it and buy it. And I've always kind of wanted that. When I'm looking for something, I don't want to have to order over Amazon. If I can go get it, that's kind of my preferred method.
Yeah. So as you're connecting all of this together, and you're looking to get transactions facilitated, you've got to keep all this stuff safe. So as you're building this out, how are you thinking about that trust of the folks to allow them to do commerce with you, and then kind of the responsibility side of storing and managing and transacting all that commerce?
Well, that's where blockchain becomes a perfect solution for us. You know, we're doing verified ID, so we know the person, who they say they are. We link in their digital wallet. We link in their goods to their store. So that person's marked in the blockchain, in the ledger, and all those transactions are ledgered. And then as other people transaction with each other, also ledgered. So it's a lot of security in there you get through the blockchain. I mean, I'm not sure you're asking me to give a blockchain class, but there's a lot of value there that solves that problem for us. So we're a perfect candidate for that. And it also comes into play with us when it comes to commerce. So we support 16 fiat currencies, and one tokenized currency today, Bitcoin, and we're going to add other tokenized currencies. Ethereum will be one of them for sure. Our chain will be one of them for sure. I'm considering others like Decred maybe. But as those currencies are in our system, we tokenize those. We put the dollars, the fiat currency, into a escrow account. Doesn't move, sits there. But within the system, the tokenized currency, the dollars, the fiat currency that's been tokenized, flows freely back and forth. It's all ledgered. It's all kept track of. It's all safe. We can roll those back if we have to. And it doesn't really hit the banking system until you want to withdraw the money and transfer it to the bank. And then we follow the normal banking rules.
Yeah. So CyberTalk Radio, we sometimes I'll do an intro first and then dive into the topic afterwards. I wanted to dive in straight here. So folks, if you're listening on 1200 WAI, you've kind of learned a little bit about what's going on with DigitalTown and how they're looking at using some new technologies across the internet to show trust in commerce. And kind of we'll elaborate on this over the course of the rest of the hour. If you're not going to be able to stick with us here on the air, you'll be able to listen to the rebroadcast and replay of this on our website at www.cybertalkradio.com on Tuesday, September 11th. You'll also be able to find it on our YouTube channel as well as your favorite podcasting service. And if you have a favorite podcasting service where the program is not available, reach out to us on Facebook or Twitter. Let us know. We will get the content added there, and we will get you a CyberTalk Radio t-shirt. So if you're listening for the first time here and you haven't heard about blockchain before, we've had some guests on going into detail and a deep dive for a full hour about the blockchain. We'll talk about it here, I think, as a way as it's related to commerce and trust and some of those aspects of it. But for the technical deep dive of what is a blockchain, why does it matter, how does it work, how do you keep your digital wallet safe, I encourage you to go to our website and check our archives out, where you'll be able to listen and get a lesson for a full hour about the depth and details of the blockchain. So as you kicked off the intro there, Frank, we've gone through, and I think almost all of our listening audience will be familiar with two ways to transact commerce on the internet locally and buy local. So one of them is Craigslist, one of them is eBay. And so on Craigslist, I mean, the way I think about it's really the Wild West. Like, you have no idea who you're buying from, what their trust is, there's no transaction history, there's nothing in there, far as I can tell. Maybe there is some community like where you can see the number of posts from somebody now, but I could never figure that out on Craigslist. And then on eBay, you have sellers and buyers, and they have like a verified identity through eBay, and then you're allowed to do some commenting about who's done what with who and from a transaction perspective, and did it work out okay.
Correct.
So you guys are more like Craigslist or more like eBay?
Way more like eBay.
Okay. Walk through and explain this in another way for folks again.
Well, each of these transactions is a verified ID, so you can't have a wallet and even be able to do a transaction unless you're a real person. And it gets back to that real person, so there's accountability involved. So that's one thing that helps us a lot. We want to add features, but one thing that supporting like reviews and things of that nature, we have the elements of that. But also what we've done is we've created a series of APIs that do all these services. The ability to do single sign-on, the ability to do local search, even the digital wallet. Our hotel booking APIs, the restaurant booking APIs, all those things we've just recently released. So we want to support others to create innovative solutions built upon this blockchain platform that we've created. So it gets really interesting. It's not just all one thing for everybody. So we're not just an eBay, as an example, eBay replacement. It's way more than that. It's kind of a new blockchain OS replacement or representation, where we're providing that SDK, those initial tools, so people can develop applications using these systems. So they can add interesting things like that. That's kind of the whole point, is we want people to take these tools and grow with it and add stuff that makes a difference in their community. Let me give you a quick example. There was a blockchain challenge. So the mayor of Austin had a blockchain challenge for the homeless about 2 weeks ago, maybe 3 weeks ago. And we were one of the winners of that. And we took our own APIs, kind of eating your own dog food, and we developed a solution for the homeless where they can use a QR code and accept payment and make payment and link their medical documents all to that same QR code using our system and our existing APIs, because the medical documents become their documents attached to the blockchain. So it's building upon that.
Yeah. As many folks have read and heard or seen things about Bitcoin at this point, and it's this anonymized anarchy digital thing where you hate the whole banking system and it's a bunch of angry people on the internet that don't want to deal with the real world. They don't want to deal with trust. They want to hide in their anonymized series of zeros and ones. I think if they've been with us through the first 10 minutes, are hearing a different side and story about how blockchains can be used and about specifically even Bitcoin as one of those currencies tied to a blockchain itself, but then will be transacted through a separate blockchain ledger that you have set up inside of DigitalTown.
That's correct. We're really blockchain. We're not Bitcoin. I mean, that's the difference. I mean, we were speaking recently, or last South By, and that was kind of the theme, is whenever someone said blockchain, the audience thought Bitcoin.
Oh, for sure. Completely those two different words, everyone thinks of the same thing right now.
Well, it's starting to change. There's more and more tokens out there that are real, that are doing real things. And the ones that were doing nefarious stuff are being weeded out. The SEC has gotten very aggressive, and people are going to jail. They're doing bad things like they should. So that's getting cleaned up. And I think the tokenized currencies are here to stay. We support 16 fiat currencies and one tokenized currency today. So maybe that'll grow to 3 or 4. We're really primarily focused on supporting the community. Those are just methods.
And for those of fiat currency is one where it's backed by a nation. It's U.S. dollars. It's probably euros. It's yen. It's
paper money. Yeah. Euros, yens, pounds, pesos.
All of those things where those bills are only worth what they're worth because you believe that the other folks will agree to that store of value, and they'll agree that using it for an exchange of commerce. But there's no physical asset backing up a U.S. dollar anymore. We went off the silver standard maybe in the 1960s and 70s, somewhere in there, and we went off the gold standard way back before that. So there's no real physical asset tied behind a U.S. dollar or a euro or anything else.
A country.
Yeah, there's just a country or a group of countries saying, we all agree to use this as an exchange of value.
Correct.
Yeah. The blockchain-based currencies are a group of people saying we agree to use this for an exchange of value that may or may not be tied to a specific country.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
It's tied to numbers.
Yeah, numbers and, people all over the world. Most of them are pretty spread out, but not as spread out maybe as the U.S. dollar.
Correct. That's definitely not.
That's a whole separate financial show and conversation we can have. So as you guys were looking to set up and build this way to do local commerce on the internet, why go down this blockchain trusted ledger route?
You kind of have to. If you don't want to end up in the Craigslist version of the world, like you were suggesting earlier, you kind of have to. Trusted identity is a big part of this. And then we want to support people who are banked and unbanked. We want to support communities that are mobile versus not mobile. We're trying to reach out to the largest audience possible.
Yeah.
So people who are digital nomads, it's a great solution. We solve a lot of problems for the homeless. But as well as small businesses, people who don't have to have a merchant account, people who are doing some banking, but they don't want to necessarily buy these additional banking services if they don't need them. So it's kind of trying to cover that whole base.
So what I'm hearing is making technology more accessible and making the benefits of technology more accessible to everyone.
Because that's right.
For folks listening, you're likely driving around in your car right now, or maybe you're listening on iHeartRadio streaming, sitting at a desk somewhere in a building. Chances are you have a permanent address, and with a permanent address, you can go open a bank account. You probably have an ID. You can go open a bank account. But for folks that don't have a permanent address, maybe don't have an ID, and without a permanent address, it's really tricky to get an ID. So you end up in this spiral of just confusion where each step that you would use to get access to the digital economy and do things is blocked by a dependency on somewhere else in that circle. And so it sounds to me like you're opening up digital commerce and identity to anyone with a mobile phone, which you can go buy those with cash. You can get a prepaid phone. You can get on the internet. You can start to access services and start to build an identity and a trust there. And you don't need all of the things to same as you would to go open up a bank account.
You in many cases with our system, you can even use someone else's computer and print out your resulting QR code, and then you can begin to do commerce.
Yeah. So you could walk over to the library.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. And that's kind of the solution that we did for the homeless, is we printed out their QR code with their verified ID. And then we're able to use that both for commerce as well as for the smart contracts component, so they can put their medical documents, their medical card connected to that same contract.
Yeah. So in one way here, so that we're in data storage and security of all these transactions, folks are worried about tampering. They're worried about who's accessing the records. How are they getting seen? How does the blockchain help you in this area? from a transaction integrity perspective, and how does it help you from just all the rest of things that you would normally worry about to secure a commerce business?
Well, the blockchain helps us in a couple of ways. The multiple ledgers is for transaction security. So there's multiple ledgers interconnected to one another. So as transactions occur, you know, that has to be mapped in different ledgers on a different system. So that kind of makes it really hard to hack. That's kind of the beauty of blockchain. And then those are actually hash references to data that's actually stored at AWS for us in this case right now. And that's the same level of security you get with your medical documents today, the same level of security you get with your credit card transactions today. So we're not really changing the model there. We're using it in a different way by leveraging blockchain.
Yeah. So, and going through and building and setting these things up, you've used the blockchain and looking at that versus doing it in a traditional manner, because you've got a history of experience doing all sorts of technology services and projects. What has been your journey on this, building a business and a system on top of blockchain versus building it with those traditional methods?
Well, there's definitely a learning journey. I mean, there's a whole new set of skills and technologies we had to get strong on, which has been done. But the I think that the biggest difference is not necessarily being able to count on as much technology as we would have otherwise. And so we're really pushing down the technology demand, down to even with that one solution I showed you or told you about, was the printed out card.
Yeah.
I mean, just for businesses today, we give them a POS, a point of sale solution, that's just the token, just the printed out QR code. That's it. I mean, they don't need anything else. They don't need to have technology. They don't need another tablet sitting there to go along with the other five they have from everyone else today. It's just a printed out QR code, and they can begin to do transactions. So bringing it down and removing so much technology through simplifying the solution, that's the hardest part.
Yeah. So if folks wanted to connect into your platform and wanted to start transacting across there, where do they find you on the internet?
Here in San Antonio, go to sanantonio.city. We have the domain name branded in the name of the city. The site is customized for the city, sanantonio.city.
Okay.
Online, the app is DigitalTown. So if you just download the app, you can do all this stuff over the app.
Okay, and in the Android and Apple
Android and Apple
app stores. Cool. You're listening to 1200 WAI. This is Cyber Talk Radio, and I'm joined this week by a couple of guests, and we haven't introduced one yet. He's also been on the program before. Javier, welcome back to Cyber Talk Radio.
Thanks for having me, Brett.
And so you've got a shirt on here that you're hanging out with us today. It says BlockQuarry, which is a part of TechQuarry. So where did this get started up for you guys, and then how are you kind of working together with Frank and the DigitalTown folks?
So TechQuarry's philosophy focuses on three pillars, and that would be smart culture, innovation, and optimization. Blockchain technology falls into the innovation sector, so BlockQuarry is really a division of TechQuarry. And I actually spoke with Rob, the CEO of DigitalTown. He had reached out to me, said I had an interesting profile. He had thought that the TechQuarry website was very interesting, very people-centric, and that's what attracted him to reach out to me or prompted him to reach out to me. So we started talking for about an hour, really hit it off, and he introduced me to Frank. We hit it off as well. And, you know, I really believe that it's organizations like this that are driving innovation and providing platforms and making it easy for entrepreneurs to bring out their creative genius is really what's going to keep the U.S. strong. It's really what has made the U.S. the global GDP leader, and it's going to keep us at the forefront. And so I believe in the project. I believe in the team. They're very, very intelligent. They're all out to do really good things and to help people. And really, you know, Frank has given me the opportunity to be one of the heads here in San Antonio as a community leader and really help the project be successful and get ingrained into the San Antonio community.
Yeah. So while we were kind of off air there for a little while before the program, we were talking about talking about how much of the commerce is on the internet at this point. And I think if you read the news, everyone's like, well, Amazon is the biggest retailer in the world. They're the biggest e-commerce retailer, but I think they're still, even counting their technology web services business, I think they're still less than half the size of Walmart.
I'm not sure, but
I think it's about right. Somewhere in that point. So as you were talking, I think that we've only just cleared, and I didn't realize that it's this small, but we just passed the 10% mark, so 90% of commerce is still not on the internet.
That's correct. That's correct.
Yeah.
In the U.S., we just passed, last year we passed the 10% mark for all for online retail. So all 10% of all retail is done online. Yeah. Took us 18 years to get to 10%.
So the internet does 10%. If you're in a market, it doesn't feel like winning, but it feels like the internet commerce is winning. If you see, as you're saying, it's like the jobs are getting impacted in local merchants. Local merchants are struggling. No one likes to see their sales shrinking. But down by 10%, it sure feels like we could weather the storm better than a lot of these retailers seem to be handling it.
Well, if you think about how the dynamics work,
yeah,
you know, 10% is actually a big number taken out of the system. It's over $500 billion a year. And then the businesses that we're talking about are small businesses. So they're not the biggest contributors to those sales. So that's sort of like the cream that's being taken. And so these guys are really good at fighting against little guys that can't fight back.
Yeah.
Just taking those businesses. And then when I was reviewing that 10% number, I presented it at South by Southwest as numbers that came from the U.S. government recently. And people thought it was kind of small, you know, 10%, no big deal. But afterwards, I talked with Gartner, the analyst company.
Yeah.
And, you know, looking at this thing, you know, you can see that it's actually accelerating. It's growing. This year it's growing between 1.2 and 1.3%. So it's just going to take about 3 years, maybe four if we're lucky, to get up to 20%. Gartner observed that in some small market, it's already past 20%. And then for those market segments, the 20% seems to be the magic number. It kills that local business. So you can't find that type of business locally anymore once it surpasses 20%.
So if we're going to continue to have the diversity of local businesses that we do now in the cities across America, and across really the rest of the world, there's going to need to be a way to connect those local businesses into the internet commerce economy.
That's right. That's right. And it's hard to play. That's why the whole local search thing I was mentioning earlier, where you can put something locally and search for it, and find it locally, buy it locally. Google doesn't support that, you know, because they're making money off of search engine optimization. They're making money off of people paying to show up. And it's a lot of money. It's not cheap. And little guys can't afford to play that game and win.
Yeah, it's expensive to advertise on the internet now that the internet has a good number of eyeballs on it. When it was early and small and there weren't that many people on the internet, it was affordable to advertise there. But now TV, radio, all those different things, internet is, you can end up spending the same amount of money on the internet as you do on the other two.
Oh, or easily more.
Yeah.
I have a lot of lawyer friends, and some of them buy hits to get business.
Yeah.
And they can easily spend $5,000 a month just to show up on search results.
Yeah.
And that's not cheap.
No.
It's not cheap at all just to get a few clients. Now, it pays for itself, but it's a tough balance. You know, it's not a complete winner. And then the other forms of media are declining as that one is going up. And so what are you faced with? You're either faced with purchasing yourself to the top, which is getting more and more expensive, or doing really well social and search engine optimization, talking about your company. And not everybody is that person. Not everybody is constantly taking selfies and pictures of their businesses and promoting it online. So not everybody is great at doing search engine optimization. It's a big task. So they can buy themselves to the top, which is expensive, or they can get really involved socially and do a lot of posts and blog posts and, you know, to engage in their community. But not a lot of people are great. Actually, most people aren't that good. That's not who they are. So what are they left with?
Yeah. So at CyberTalk Radio, we do try to be active on social media and those other places. So you can find us on Twitter, Facebook. We do not have an Instagram. And we do have a YouTube page where you can see still photos of us and all the other guests in the program while you do listen to the audio. We do not record live video in the studio here, as it allows me to scratch my eye or something if I need while we're going. We're going to take a quick break for a news, traffic, and weather update at the bottom of the hour. And we will be back with Frank, where we're going to talk about the APIs on this. If you are a developer out there in the audience looking to integrate, build your first blockchain-based application, this is going to be a great opportunity to learn and go ahead and get out there and do something not only that will get you some blockchain experience, but help enable small business across San Antonio or any other city that you're listening in out there on the internet. Welcome back to Cyber Talk Radio. I'm your host, Bret Piatt, a 20-year internet security veteran. We're talking this week with Frank Robles of DigitalTown, who's building a platform to allow blockchain-based commerce, creating an open and accessible and trusted marketplace for small businesses and people that would like to buy local. Could be a larger business as well. You could connect into this platform, but if you've got locations in a city, if you want to connect those consumers out there to your system, or even for B2B purchases, I think all sorts of things could happen. We covered quite a bit of that in the first half of the program. So if you just picked us up on the radio after the news, traffic, and weather update, you can listen to the rebroadcast of this and replay on your favorite podcasting service. It'll go online on Tuesday, September 11th. If you do have a favorite podcasting service and we are not showing up there, reach out to us on Twitter or Facebook. Let us know. We will add our content and get you a CyberTalk Radio t-shirt. If you did stick with us through that break, I'd promise that Frank was going to talk to you as a software developer about some of the APIs on the platform and how you can build apps and build businesses and integrate in with what's going on at DigitalTown. So Frank, can you help for the developer intro? Where do they get started and connected?
Well, we recently released our 2.0 APIs. You can find them on our developer forum. It's at forum.digitaltown.com, and it's free to sign up. The APIs are free. There's a links there so you can read about them. There's a sandbox so you can play with them. And then if you actually want to start using them, you need to contact us. You need to actually create a DigitalTown account, and then we'll give you authorization keys.
No, that's good. So back to your whole thing of trust again. So yeah, not just anyone can go in and start doing anything in the production world.
No. But we're trying to help people get going. We're trying to make it easy for them. And the whole concept is that we know we can't solve the world's problems all from one app. But I do know that other people have their own missions. You know, I kind of view that from my own perspective as putting wood behind someone else's arrow. They have their own missions. They have their own teams. They have their own desire to solve a problem. That's all great. I want to support them. I want to make it easier for them and help drive that success. Because when you look at making a company, making an app, that's where a lot of the risk occurs, is the execution risk. So as I can provide APIs to these people and remove the execution risk or help eliminate it, limit it at least, then they can be more successful and it helps everybody.
So for a developer, what kind of skills do I need to work with these APIs?
Well, we support multiple languages. So most of my coding lately is in Python, but we support PHP as well and pretty much everything in between. So it's not a language issue, but you do need to have basic programming skills. So it's usually be used by a person who has some experience developing. But we limit a lot of the problems you normally have to solve. Like when you're creating an application, you need people to log in with username and password and authentication. We've solved that. We have a single sign-on solution that people can build into the application, and they can leverage that authenticated ID, building on that blockchain platform.
Yeah.
Say you want to have a commerce solution. You want to be able to take, accept, and pay money. Great. You can build in our digital wallet, and you get that capability, along with the other features supporting multiple currencies. I have got one company that I'm talking to that has a pretty interesting solution where people go on trips, like a business might take a bunch of employees on a trip and they're maintaining that, helping them find each other, having an agenda of items. The one thing they're missing is restaurants. They want to be able to coordinate, you know, who's purchasing what from a restaurant, what restaurant we're going to go to. And so they're actually going to use our restaurant API. We list all the restaurants. We already have the menus in there. They're indexed. They can search them. They can order food. It makes it a lot simpler. I'm talking to another company that's interested in our hotel booking APIs. We've got about 1.4 million hotels in our system. All of the booking information is there. So we provide an API to access that and book a hotel room. And so one developer I'm talking to wants to integrate that into his app because he's doing other travel solutions around hotels.
Yeah. So I mean, it sounds like, as well as I'm thinking through this from a small business or a startup perspective, accepting multiple currencies is really complicated.
Yep.
So the fact that I could plug into your APIs and then I can accept 16 currencies plus Bitcoin.
That's right.
That could be a great way for me to do that in a simple manner. And then it also sounds like with the way the money is pooled inside of the platform, you're lowering some of the transaction fees to swap services. If I were to kind of view that wallet that I have with you and then buy other things through the platform, I'm going to lower some of my transaction fees.
Oh, tremendously so. I mean, in some cases, it's we take it down to zero. In other cases, it's only 1%.
Yeah. So with this kind of breadth of APIs, do you have some example stories of apps that are being built or people that you're talking to about things that they're working on?
I mentioned some of them earlier. I'll tell you a couple more. There's one company that I'm working with that are very deep into this. They've come up with basically a CRM solution targeted at fitness centers that are doing yoga. So very targeted yoga fitness centers app. And they're building in our single sign-on and our wallet so people can do transactions quickly working with that yoga fitness center and removing a lot of problems that they normally have in, basically removing friction in that system. So they can do their business, they can provide a yoga service, and they don't need to worry about logins, username, passwords, or payment. They can just take care of in the solution. So that's a pretty good example for us that's something happening now. There's another company that's developing something interesting that I've talked with. I'm not sure they want me to share who they are just yet, but they have a collections idea where they're doing collections on medical debt as an example. And the collection company is kind of left with one option. They call you up, maybe you have a medical bill for $500. They're pushing you to pay them $500. And all they can do is call you and push. And unless you give them the $500, they can call you or they can mail you or they can ding your credit. That's kind of the only options they have.
Yeah.
So their solution is thinking that they would use us to allow people to make micropayments. So they can say, okay, I acknowledge I have this debt, but instead of giving you $500 today, I'll automatically pay you $10 a month. And so that's another interesting solution that I see that's happening.
Yeah. So for building and developing an app, so if you were to sit down, you're pretty familiar with your own APIs. So if I wanted to set up just a basic web page, I was going to build a web app where I could allow users to log in and then users could post a comment after they logged in. So just kind of a simple, almost hello world app, but just to integrate to that authentication API on your system. And then I've got my web page that allows people to just wallboard comment. For developing that type of setup, are you looking at sitting down for a day to get that kind of thing up and going, or is this the complexity level of the APIs, are these things that you need a team of developers for weeks on?
No, it's not at all. It's if you're a novice, you should be able to do it by yourself in an afternoon. If you're a well-practiced developer, this is just a few moments to do what you said. We created a full app for complete commerce and for the mayor's blockchain challenge and won. And we did that over the weekend.
Yeah.
And then that include taking money, receiving money, printing out, cards, and also managing medical documents.
And so when you say mayor's blockchain challenge, so for those listening on the radio, Mayor of Austin.
Mayor of Austin.
We did not have a blockchain challenge here in San Antonio yet. And Mayor, if you're listening out there, we would love to have one, host one here down in the geek community. We'll figure out how to get that organized.
I'm all over it.
Yeah. So for your team that was working on that blockchain challenge for the weekend, how many folks were on the team?
Oh, it was only two of us and an intern.
Okay.
So he was helping out a little bit.
Yeah. And so this is one as I'm trying to kind of hammer on this point for a second. Frank talks about making all these things easier for people, making it easier to do these things. And this is a great example. As you get down, you're like, this is not actually believable. Well, it is believable. It's really happening. You can go look up the news articles. So you can do and build all these things. You can internet connect your business. You can accept a whole bunch of currencies. If you're a business here in San Antonio along that World Heritage Site journey and you're like, I would love to accept Japanese yen.
Yep.
You could do that tomorrow.
That's right.
Yeah.
The competing team, there were several teams there. There were seven competing teams. We were one of the smallest. The team that won the first prize had 8 or 9 developers, many guys from IBM. I mean, it was like solid, strong, heavy development team. And we were, 2.5 guys.
Oh, that's great stuff. So, Javier, as well, we were chatting off the air for a little while about university folks getting involved in community.
Yeah, so from a global GDP perspective, there's a book called The Cummings Job War, and what they're saying is that in order for the U.S. to stay on top of the rankings in the economic global economy, that really the local, it happens at the local level. So the universities, the local government representatives, and strong community leaders and mentors and innovators like people at DigitalTown really need to start working together at places like Geekdom and really synergizing to help the community and help the entrepreneurs to develop new jobs and create new jobs, develop new companies, right? That's what's really driving the economy. You know, and Frank, I think, shared some stats earlier, I believe, that, you know, 80% of the small businesses in the U.S. that help drive this economy have 5 employees or less, right? And so there's a lot of companies being born at places like here in Geekdom, and universities are pumping out really, you know, solid candidates here locally with technology. And there's a lot of good mentors that can help these new leaders of the future to get, you know, let go of their past and let go of their fear or break through their fear to develop more companies and jobs within the local community. But it really starts at the local level.
So predicting here out in the future for a little bit. So what does success look like 5 years from now?
Well, there's two parts of that. One, I want to be clear that we don't expect to supplant the existing systems and infrastructures and solutions. We expect to be an alternative or in addition to. So like right now with our system, you can actually use us as a form of payment for a lot of systems that are out there today. That said, yeah, I want market penetration. I want people to adopt it. I'm looking forward to people joining this movement and realizing that this can make a significant and positive impact to their communities. I mean, help each other. Help businesses sign up and use this. Help citizens sign up and use this. Help them interact with each other and use this form of exchange to reduce the cost and keep money local in the local community.
And you're rolling out city by city with this, right?
Well, we're focused in Central Texas right now. And we were kind of spread out. We did some work in London. We've done some work in Miami. We've done some work in other parts of the world. But we've decided recently, a few months ago, to really focus all our efforts on Central Texas. And so that's what we're doing. Yeah. So as we build up Central Texas, we can use that as a model for the rest of the country and the rest of the world. And we already have a lot of strong adoption across the world, but we want to get all the systems worked out, the details worked out on the back end, the interactions with businesses work out using those examples. And we thought Central Texas is the best place to do that.
Yeah. I mean, many of the things that the mission of your company wants to solve, we have challenges with here in San Antonio. We've had some guests in the program talking about some of those things where many of the houses here do not have high-speed internet access, and many of the folks here do not have a bank account. So those challenges in this area can be potentially solved again with what you guys are working on.
Absolutely.
So I think it's a great test market and from a mission focus as well to enable you to really help connect a whole bunch of folks into this internet economy that are not connected there today.
Well, I'm a big believer in this community already, and you're absolutely right. I think this solution is pretty much custom made for this community. And I think it can be leveraged across the country, but I think it can make the huge impact here now. Just express, you know, my commitment to the community. I'm also a volunteer for the YMCA, and I have been for many years. You know, the San Antonio YMCA, the Greater San Antonio.
Yeah.
And it's really important. I mean, the work that the Y does and the work that we're trying to do makes a difference in this community, and we want to build on that.
You're listening to 1200 WAI. This is Cyber Talk Radio, and we're talking about DigitalTown this week. We kind of gave a overview of where you can learn about the APIs for DigitalTown, create your own apps that integrate into the platform, and want to kind of segue from there into Javier and talking with him a little bit more as the community leader here. So if you're a developer, you're interested in this stuff, you're hanging out in Geekdom, Javier, where do folks find you and how do they get plugged in? What kind of things are you going to do to work with and help developers in this community?
So to contact me, you can really reach out at, on LinkedIn or Facebook. My tag is typically Javier Guerra 360, you know, either one at Javier Guerra 360. You reach out to TechQuarry at techquarry.com and just contact us page, reach out. So you want to get involved. Really, we're doing a lot of different things in the community. You know, Frank has a lot of great knowledge and a lot of great experience in hackathons. You know, he runs a hackathon group up in Austin, and he's, of course, been very successful at different city challenges in Austin as well. And so what we want to do here is we really would just want to get the community involved and get help them to understand the benefits of this platform. You know, anybody that's running a business knows that it takes multiple different things to run a business. You need, you know, systems, you need communications, you need marketing, you need a platform, you need a website, you need all of this stuff. Well, DigitalTown has really built a solid platform where you can accept 16 different currencies. You can accept Bitcoin. They're doing marketing for you in a sense because you're going to be listed on the website. You know, they have these great systems that tie into to different technical systems. It's almost like you're leveraging multiple of their employees to run your business if you plug into their platform, right? And you know, and then partnering, you know, through Geekdom and having all of these different innovators here locally and mentors all over the place, there's so much power in that, that not only can you come here and work with other local people and partner, but you have a platform that you can plug your company into and get free marketing and free, you know, back-end services, so to speak. You know, we're doing different meetups through Blockspace, so where we're going to different restaurants and helping them get set up with accepting, you know, cryptocurrencies and get it set up on the platform and educating them on how to use these things. And then other people can come in and literally pay for their food, you know, through the platform. They can learn how to do tips because this is all a new way of doing things, but it's actually very streamlined and very easy to do once you know what you're doing. A great example, yesterday I went and got a haircut at the Frost Building downtown. It's right next door. And there's a lady that's been in there for 25 years. She doesn't use the internet. She doesn't use anything. And I told her, look, well, you need to get on to the DigitalTown platform because people are going to know that you're there. You're going to be able to start accepting different forms of payment. She only accepts cash because it's too overwhelming for her. And, you know, and in comes somebody like DigitalTown that makes it very easy. So, we're, you know, we're going to help her to get set up and help her potentially advertise to get another person on her other chair that she needs another stylist there. And it's right here in the Frost Bank Building right next door in downtown that nobody knows about. So just different examples like that. There's some upcoming hackathons that, you know, Frank has put together a team that are going to come down to San Antonio and help out.
There's some San Antonio-based hackathon.
Absolutely. Yeah. And so really it's really just helping the community. What's going to keep our country strong and what's going to keep our economy growing, it's going to be the small business and local communities. It has to happen at the local city level. And, you know, our community has such great potential. There's so much room here. There's so many great companies that are moving here, and people like Graham Weston and Lorenzo Gomez and Geekdom are all, you know, helping to amplify this thing. Well, you know, with DigitalTown coming in and providing the platform, it's just going to make it all the much more powerful. And really the community is really starting to come together, and there's great things on the horizon for San Antonio, but we really have to work together as a team and take advantage of the resources that are here at our disposal.
Yeah. As you were talking, and it kind of finally the light bulb went off for me, putting my business into the DigitalTown platform is like buying, like from a rental perspective, I'm just getting real estate now inside of a shopping mall. There's going to be customers coming through there. They're going to see my business now in there, except I don't have to pay really expensive per square foot rent to be in DigitalTown.
You pay zero.
Yeah, so no rent. So as a small business, I mean, one of the hardest things is finding new customers, like the barbershop that you went to get your haircut done. For her, she's going to get customers via word of mouth and other things, but maybe that walking by there, you see it on that street downtown. But increasing that visibility, paying for those visible storefronts in the retail world has always been really expensive. And the DigitalTown is going to change that and make this more open and more accessible for other businesses now that couldn't have necessarily afforded it in the past.
Yeah, we make it easy for them to, you know, the concept is to see the area through locals' eyes. And so we're trying to expose that. That's the system's all built with that in mind, where you're searching local, buying local. So it makes it really easy for this shop that no one knows about, it's hard to find even, to pop up. It's going to be there. It's going to be highly visible. And then soon we're going to make it even easier to even find those locations and book appointments with those locations.
Yeah. Because you've got a pretty comprehensive set of APIs already, and
it's only going to get better.
And it sounds, as I'm hearing you talk about this, that really building on top of the blockchain platform after your initial learning curve has made life easier for you and your development team?
Well, we're doing the hard part. None of us would say easier. No. We're trying to make it easier for people using it. And so as a user that we used it through that blockchain challenge, as a user, yeah, a lot easier. You can get a lot done fast, but it takes a lot of effort to make something easy. So it's a tremendous amount of effort. It costs a tremendous amount of money. I mean, it's not easy making something easy for other people. But the joy is once that you've done that, then it's just a button click for somebody or for code. You're just copying in a couple of lines of code, and then you can do some damage.
Yes. So on the web, if you're listening in San Antonio, sanantonio.city. If you're listening in Austin, because 1200 WAI is a pretty strong radio signal, it could be austin.city. Yeah. And these are a new top-level domain, so everything on the internet is not .com. There's other stuff out there. You want to? How did you guys go about picking the .city domain?
Well, we bought every city we could.
Yeah,
we have over 20,000 of them right now. We also have about many .laws also, because we have a law directory, so people find lawyers online. So we have like Austin.law and San Antonio.law as well.
For the developers, where that website for those checking in again to get connected in for the APIs.
It's forum.digitaltown.com. It's free to sign up. And then once you sign up, make sure you also create a DigitalTown account. Once you share that with us, what email address you use to create your DigitalTown account, then we can give you API keys.
Cool.
Yeah, the top-level domain names are interesting. And recently, Google has started indexing those. So now as you list those businesses on our system, you know, that'll get indexed. And it can be searched and found on Google. And actually, we're doing a lot of effort on promoting those. So you guys talked about a list of putting the businesses there for free, which is fantastic. We're actually going the next step, and we're doing the search engine optimization, and we're promoting those businesses online.
So building I'm going to call it a phone book of the internet.
That's right.
For depending on how sophisticated you are out there in the audience, you used to buy an ad in the Yellow Pages. You had to pay for that. You don't really have to pay anything other than your time. To get your business into DigitalTown. So if you spend a little bit there, and if you're not a software developer and want to connect in and do those sorts of things, reach out to Javier and the community here, and they will either help you out and get you connected with somebody who can help you out or show you how you can learn on your own to go build and do the things that you may need to do to run and lead a business into this next century. If you want to learn more about some of the options and opportunities for tech education as you're listening to all this going, man, I have to go do this, check out our past catalog of episodes on iTunes. Or I'm an Android user, and I like Pocket Cast quite a bit. They do not pay the program anything, but I think it's a great podcasting app. We've had folks on from CodeUp. We've had folks on from Open Cloud Academy, the Microsoft Software and Systems Academy, and all sorts of different places here, Alamo Colleges and others, where you can learn about what tech education and programming opportunities are available out there to you. Closing out, Frank, for those listening in the audience, if they want to go get set up, get started, San Antonio City, they can go there. They can also go to digitaltown.com, where they've got a walkthrough.
That's correct. Both those sites make it really easy to just click on it, sign up, and begin the process. Once you create an account, you want to click on the link to add your business, if you're adding a business, and it's just a simple step through. Just a couple screens and you're done.
And you'll be able to listen to the rebroadcast of this. If you just joined here at the end, you're here about this DigitalTown thing and you wanted to know more, it'll go up on our website at www.cybertalkradio.com on Tuesday, September the 11th. Thank you, Javier and Frank, both for joining us and really showing folks that blockchain is more than just Bitcoin.
Thank you, Brett.